Shipmates, and that Jaron Cacophony be telling me you be listening to the Power of Three podcast. I be Captain Kenny Smith, and I be here with my shipmate, me landlubber, me cabin boy. He'd better introduce himself.
Sure, I be like a bushy badger beard, which is curious enough for the show we're listening to. I be Steevie Day with a growth that can shave off a door.
Oh dear.
Yeah. I think I'm going to return to normal voice now.
I'm a bit bristly. Sorry. I'm on a holiday. I grow a beard.
Yeah. Anyway, you're back with the Power of Three podcast. And today we're continuing our look at those 10th Doctor books from the BBC that were published in the 2000 and somethings. And today we're taking a look at The Pirate Loop by Simon Guerrier. And this, of course, is an interesting one because Steevie, this was your first original Doctor Who novel, wasn't it?
It was. I should say it was my first original Doctor Who novel from the BBC from that era, because I did read Virgin books back in the day, one or two, but this is also the first book I have read in probably 4 or 5 years, Kenny. And thank you for saying, would you like to read it? It's not very long. And I thoroughly enjoyed it. Although, on my iPad, it's a very target-orientated book. 178 pages, and then it just stops, according to my PDF. Was that not the old target joke? How to write a target book?
Yes. Yeah. Cut it off after it was 128 pages.
128 pages, sorry. But anyway, yep. thank you for making me read the book, Kenny. I thoroughly enjoyed it.
Fantastic. Let's find out a little bit more about it as I now call it up. So, Steevie, The Pirate Loop, was the 20th novel in the BBC New Series Adventures series, written by Simon Guerrier, and featured the 10th Doctor and Martha Jones. Shall I tell you what the cover blurb has to say about it?
Go on, tell me what the cover blurb has to say.
The Doctor's been everywhere and everywhen in the whole of the universe, and seems to know all the answers. But ask him what happened to the starship Brilliant, and he hasn't the first idea. Did it fall into a sun or black hole? Was it shot down in the first moments of a galactic war? And what's this about a secret experimental drive? The Doctor is skittish, but if Martha is so keen to find out, he'll land the TARDIS on the Brilliant a few days before it vanishes. Then they can see for themselves. Soon the Doctor learns the awful truth, and Martha learns that you need to be careful what you wish for. She certainly wasn't hoping for mayhem, death, and badger-faced space pirates. And now, let's hear a brief excerpt from The Talking Book, read by Freema Agyeman.
Her flesh was dark and patchy, showing long-healed scars. The badgers turned around to stare at her, just as amazed as Martha. It's impolite to gawp at someone, said Mrs. Winsworth. I expected better from you at least, Martha. Sorry, said Martha. She took a step back, bumped into the bar and stumbled. Before she could do anything, Archie rushed forward and snatched Joss's gun. Martha looked around, but the only thing to hand was the tray of cheese and pineapple sticks. Well, grinned Dash, raising his gun at her. Wait, said Martha, desperate. Oh, I wouldn't worry about it, dear, said Mrs. Wingsworth. It's over very quickly. Dash aimed the gun. Martha grabbed the tray, hurled all the cheese and pineapple sticks at Dash, and made a break for the door. As Dash swatted at the descending nibbles, Joss pounced from behind him, wrestling Martha to the ground. All right, admitted Martha, winded. Joss nodded, smiled, and clambered off her. Martha looked up. Dash's gun was pointed in her face. Go on then, she said. Don't, cried Archie. But Dash had already squeezed the trigger. and Martha grabbed the empty silver tray and held it between her and the gun. Pink light hit the tray so hard she nearly let it go, but despite the heat searing her fingers, she hung on for dear life. And then the blast of light was over. She lowered the tray, her hands shaking from the onslaught, her fingers raw with pain. "Drat!" said Dash, and raised his gun again. Joss seemed to reach out a paw to stop him, a strange look on her face. He swatted her paw away, and Joss lost her balance, toppling over and hitting the floor hard. Steam curled up from her unmoving body. "Huh?" said Dash. "You're shot, dear," said Mrs. Wingsworth from over by the door. "It bounced off Martha's shield and hit your friend." As Dash fell to his knees beside Joss's body, Martha got to her feet and made a dash for the door. She still had the tray in her raw and throbbing hands. "Get after her!" Dash yelled. Martha raced through the ballroom towards the staircase. She took the stairs two at a time, but she knew she couldn't outrun Archie. She turned around. Archie stood at the end of the corridor, cradling his gun. He pointed it at her, then lowered it again. "Well then," she said, with the same sexy voice she'd tried on him before. "Yeah," said Archie. He glanced down. "I like those." She looked down. In her hands, the silver tray was laden with cheese and pineapple sticks. "Take one," she said. Archie grinned at her and reached out. She hit him hard in the face with the tray. He dropped his gun, staggered back, and she kicked him with all her might. Archie fell back but caught her foot and brought her down with him. They scrabbled on the floor, Martha biting and kicking for her life. She felt a sudden hot pain in her gut, and then she could not breathe. Looking down, she saw the dagger Archie had thrust into her stomach. "Ack," she said to him, and she died.
Yeah. So, Steevie, tell me, what did you enjoy about this? Because I'm curious to know, you know, somebody who's coming into this novel range and a different style.
One of the main things I really enjoyed about it was the author has got the Doctor and Martha off to a T, both on their how they speak, how they think, and what they're doing. And that's sometimes a bit of a hard thing for authors to do, especially in this kind of shortened thing, because you get some people who've got them completely down like he has, and you've got others that go off on a tangent and introduce new things to you that just don't, that seem out of character. So that's the first thing. I could just read it through and they were alive in my brain. And I loved the concept of space badgers. Now, to me, there were more space raccoons because I was more getting, I was going to say Gromit from the Avengers. He wasn't in the Avengers. Rocket! That's kind of what I was getting, but, yeah. You know, slightly taller and in badger form. And I think, well, that's what books are meant to do to you. They're meant to conjure up ideas to you. The mouthless engineers, I had minions in leather aprons with wrenches. But again, that's what books do. And everyone just seemed nicely formed. I found the captain and her first officer slightly less well formed. It's not that I didn't like them, but the passengers, and I've forgotten her name. I'm going to call her Mrs. Wrigglesworth. That is not her name. What is her name?
Mrs. Wingsworth.
Mrs. Wingsworth. She was a lovely character. Mrs. Wingsworth, not Mrs. Wrigglesworth. Mrs. Wingsworth. And, you know, the fact that she accepted eventually being shot and coming back to life was just fun. Again, back to the badgers, the fact that you had them being amazed at pineapple chunks on a stick and
the cheese.
And the cheese, and the fact that you ate them all and they all came back, and then the robot, you know, just being blown into oblivion and coming back and back. Just a nice story. Complicated enough, but not overcomplicated. I'm quite interested in the war, should I be? Am I going to find out more about the war later, or is that a throwaway?
It's gone. It's a throwaway.
Oh, I suppose But that was one that was wondering, ooh, where's that coming in? Or are we talking Time War here? Whatever. But yeah, all in all, just a great quick read. Thoroughly enjoyable.
I think, as you say, the characterization is great. I think the fact that, you know, the badgers, the anthropomorph, I can't say it. I'm going to try again later and speak to Simon. The anthropomorphization, I'm going to say it again, the anthropomorphization of an Earth animal into an alien, obviously it fits in with the cat people yep. from New Earth, the Jadoon, things like that. That all sort of ties in quite nicely, so it's very much in keeping with the TV show. And the wibbly-wobbly timey-wimey-ness of it, only thinking what on Earth is going on. And you can imagine that you could believe that you'd seen this on TV, couldn't you, if you'd read the book back in the day?
You could. It there's nothing in there that you could say couldn't happen. I think what would be lost, and I meant to mention it, is the names of the badgers. Okay, because you're not expecting a badger to be called Archie or Joss or Dash. Well, maybe you are Dash the Badger, but I don't know where he got his ideas from for these names, but they are perfect for badgers. If I ever have a pet badger, I'm coming back to this book to work out what to call them.
You're going to find out very soon where the badger names came from. Ooh. From the pirates, from Simon. Excellent. When he has a chat with us. But oh, I think it's a real gem. It's because I was thinking, like, oh, working my way through these and picking them off the shelf, I thought, oh, you know, you'll remember these all pretty well. You'll remember something about all of them. I remember thinking, this one's really good fun. And when I was thinking, oh, this would be a good one to discuss, and I thought, I think you'll like this one because obviously it's Doctor Who books, something you just, or and books in general, or something you've not had a lot of time to read through work and everything else that you've got going on in real life. So I thought, you'll probably enjoy this one. So a good recommendation.
No, absolutely. Yay. Absolutely. A brilliant recommendation. I think the sign of a good book is when you come to the end, especially, because I hate books that are good, 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 and then there's too many endings. It's like films that have too many endings.
Yeah.
Sometimes things just have to stop. You know, we don't need an explanation every time. You know, let us think, ooh, I wonder what happens next. That's a good way to stop. The last sentence is really sad. You know, I'm just going to read it. The party aboard the Brilliant would go on forever. Yet for those who would choose one last chance to escape, the last dance had begun. That's really sad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a lot of ambiguity in there because you hope that everybody will stay on the ship and just carry on partying for the rest of their lives, but some may not choose to.
You don't know who will and who won't. Now, we know Martha and the Doctor chose not to, but there's another decision made. What if? You know? What if our 14th decided where he was happiest, and that was his last trip?
Yeah.
With hindsight, it just, when you get to a last paragraph like that, and I close the book and I think, sniff, that was good. And that is a sign of a good book.
Yeah. Do you know what you need after that, Stevie? The healing power of canopies.
Canopies. A good canopy. Sorry, I'll. Or I could be doing with a good canopy, Kenny. A canopy, Kenny.
Do you know what the pirate said on his 80th birthday?
I should know.
Aye, matey. Anyway, let's move on from that. Shall we maybe invite the author to introduce himself and tell us a little bit about the writing process behind this one?
Or I think that would be a good decision, Pirate Kenny.
Yeah, I think let's have around 45 minutes of Simon Guerrier chat, because he likes this one too.
Hello, I'm Simon Guerrier, and I wrote Doctor Who in the Pirate Loop.
I suppose that this must have been a bit of a delight for you to do, given that you'd done one of the last previous Doctor adventures, and the word count would have been significantly higher.
Yes, so The Time Travellers, which was published in November 2005, was 80,000 words, which I think was a bit much. I certainly remember struggling with that, and looking at the book now, I think you can tell several of those books, I think it would be fair to say, were could have done with being a bit shorter. And obviously by the time The Time Travelers came out, not only was there Doctor Who on TV, but also the first two sets of Ninth Doctor novels were out and had sold extraordinarily well. And I mean, The Time Travelers didn't even meet its, I don't think they printed enough copies for it to meet its advance, so I've never had royalties from that book, whereas I think the writers of the Ninth Doctor books were able to retire by yachts. I think they're funding space programs at the moment. And so that was clearly the way it was going to go. And I talked to Justin Richards, who was the creative director of the BBC books, you know, and had bits of chats with him. And, you know, he kind of was saying writers for these new series books have got to be cleared by the production team in Cardiff. So it tends to be people who've got a connection to the BBC. So they're cleared to see scripts and bits and pieces anyway. So I just, you know, was kind of, well, maybe that's not for me. But, you know, I've had my chance of doing a book and that's it. So, yeah, it came out of the blue in March 2007 when he said, not only are we going to do books, but we're going to do an extra three books a year that will come out. So they were coming out in, what, April, I think, to coincide with the launch of each new series. And then in September, so that they'd kind of be in the Christmas market. And then they said, we're going to release some just before Christmas as well as a kind of last thing. So it was me, James Swallow, and Trevor Baxendale. Yeah, so Justin had, I mean, his brief to me was he wanted something set in space. He'd like the Time Travelers, so thought something time travel-y would work, and something similarly with a sort of time travel loop in it. And we had talked about the stories I liked that had been on TV. And when I said I really liked Aliens of London, which I just thought the script of that had, it's really funny, but it's also quite very moving, and it jumps around a lot, and it you know, you never quite know where it's going to go. That kind of freewheeling thing I really liked. So we had a bit of a chat about that. And yeah, and then within days, we were knocking ideas back and forth. It was a very, very quick turnaround, I think, because I had to deliver it to be out for December. It had to go to press in October, so it all had to be signed off by September. You know, it's a very fast turnaround. And I had loads of other work on at the time. I was sort of up to my waist in the inside story of Bernie Summerfield for Big Finish, and also judging the short story competition that we were doing at the time, the Short Trips competition. But yeah, so I kind of said to Justin, yeah, I'll be fine, I just won't sleep, and I'll get it done.
I suppose it would have made a real difference, whereas with the Benny book, you were doing interview after interview after interview, checking facts, double checking facts, and getting people's stories to hopefully match up. Whereas at least with this, you could let yourself off the leash and you're in control of the narrative.
Yeah, yeah, it was extraordinary. I finished the Benny book at the end of June, I think, by which time the storyline for Pirate Loop had been approved, the episodes had been on. Because one of the things was I didn't know anything about Martha Jones when Justin sort of first got in contact, because she hadn't been on TV. So part of the idea was that I wouldn't need special briefing on any behind the scenes stuff, because I could just watch the episodes as they went out and work out while the series was on where my book was going to fit in that run and things like that. So, you know, there was no point in getting started too early on in the process. So I finished the Benny book, and then, yeah, a bit to my amazement, it just blew by. I think I wrote a draft in 2-3 weeks. I just knocked through it. And blah, 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 blah. And then went over it and revised it. So, yeah, I just remember it as being really fun. And I think you can probably tell I was enjoying myself.
I think it does come across. Of course, something that you see earlier on, of course, you did send me an interview you'd done back in the day on writing Pirate Loop for the Doctor Appreciation Society. And you mentioned in that that Joe Lidster had helped you a wee bit with getting to grips with Martha, and there's a nice wee reference to that in the book as well with MySpace.
Yeah. So Joe was working for the BBC website team, and he did a number of things, but one of the things he did was Martha Jones's MySpace pages. So she was updating them week by week as she had her adventures. And to do that, Joe had gone through all the scripts of that year of Doctor Who and had noted everything we learn about Martha. And if I remember right, he did that in black text, and then in blue text he kind of added, well, from this we can suppose this, and from that we can suppose that. And then he went through it again, and I think in red text, I think that's how it worked, he kind of made some, well, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to fit a little thing in here and whatever. So it was amazing. And I think that had been approved by Russell T. Davis or the Cardiff team. So he had kind of a green light for all of that. And that's what his MySpace pages were being based on. So not only did that give me a bit of insight into Martha's character and gave me a bit of extra depth for her, but also I could then weave what I was doing into what he'd done. So I mentioned MySpace, and he in the MySpace pages mentions the adventures with the space pirate badgers, so we kind of acknowledged each other, which was really fun. And that was really nice to kind of tie that all up together, and you get the feeling that there's something consistent going on. But it was all just a very creative, exciting time. There was lots going on. The BBC website was also doing things like getting school kids to read the Doctor Who books. So I got reviewed by a bunch of 8-year-olds, I think, or maybe they were 11, or however old they were. And one of them really didn't like it, which was very funny.
That's great. They obviously were badger haters.
Well, it's just, you know, but it was normally, if you get a review from a sort of grown-up reviewer and they go, oh, I didn't like this, I thought it was a bit boring, you're like, oh, okay. But from a 11-year-old, that was absolutely fine.
Well, because I think just looking through the piece for Dwas, you'd a few ideas initially. A society that lived in a huge tree. Another where Martha arrived in the distant future to find out she was a celebrity. Martha riding a dragon. And yeah, this sort of thing. It's interesting how some of these ideas you kept and reworked later.
Yeah. Well, I've always kept notebooks. So I'm always cycling through my ideas and, you know, what works and what whatever. They wanted something reasonably big scale. And they wanted something that had a kind of visual feel to it, so that it kind of matched the feel and energy of the TV show. So I did what I usually did. I sort of sat with a cup of tea and just scribbled ideas in my notebook, daydreaming, really. Nothing's really changed in the 100 years since then. I still do that. And some of those ideas I worked up as other things. So a couple of them have ended up as Big Finish things or whatever. Not necessarily that I've used the, you know, they're just the sort of seed ideas, and then you have to develop them and work out where they're going to go. But the spaceship idea, the idea of a time loop on a spaceship, really appealed to Justin. And what he liked more than anything was the idea that this was a small, confined spaceship. I'd been to Bristol and had a tour of the SS Great Britain. And the thing that really struck me about that was even the first class berths were very small, and I'm tall, and I wouldn't have fitted in anything. There was nowhere on that ship that I could stand up straight. So even if I paid for a first class ticket, I'd have had I'd have had difficulty sleeping anywhere because all the berths were too small. So that was kind of the idea. And Justin just liked that idea that space travel would still be hard. I think Russell T. Davis had said about, there'd been a note or something, I think, on the Impossible Planet and the Satan Pit, where he'd referred to these space travelers as pioneers, but the idea was that space would be hard work. And that kind of aesthetic idea was what I was kind of picking up on. So even first class would be a bit limited. And immediately that gave it a setting that we could play within.
you definitely get that feeling. It's sort of with the spaceship brilliant, and you've got the sort of, we get the impression that there's one area is nice and the rest of the place is pretty much beaten up and perhaps not had the same money spent on it. Just sort of one room which looks great, and then after that you're pretty much slumming it.
Yeah, I think that just came from my tour of the Great Britain, which was, you know, only the elite people would have had carpet on the floor and whatever. So that, yeah, that was kind of the idea. But also what that meant was that the places within the ship were distinct, so that I could set up different environments and you'd know where you were within it. Because, you know, on screen, you can do that by, you have rooms that are different colours or, you know, that have different design aesthetics. In print, because it's a loop and you've got people going back to the same spaces, I had to make sure that those spaces were distinctive and clear.
Yeah. Before we come to the Badgers, quite a, you know, distinctive cast of guest characters. Obviously, there's Gabriel, the robot, and we get to meet the passengers, including Mrs. Wingsworth.
Yeah, I named Mrs. Wingsworth after one of my old teddy bears. I can't remember why. I had a various stuffed toy owls, and one of them looked quite smart and was known as William Wingsworth. I can't even say it. Yes, I can't remember why that struck me as the name. But what I had in mind with Mrs. Wingsworth was Mr. Tickle, the Roger Hargreaves character, with the extraordinary long arms. And part of that came from, I was thinking about the mechanics of the canapes and the treats and the things. And the thing about Mr. Tickle, which really tickled me as a kid, is he could lie in bed and reach one of his extraordinarily long arms downstairs and go to the biscuit tin and grab a biscuit. Mm-hmm. And that still appeals to me. So that's kind of where that began, that there'd be a character that was like that. And as you kind of work out the plot and things, that became Mrs. Wingsworth. And I think the other thing that was a big influence on this book was my grandfather, who lived on the other side of town from my mum and dad when I was growing up, so I saw a great deal of. He died the day that Smith and Jones broadcast. So that was, what, the end of March 2007? And he was in his 90s and had been quite frail for some time. But it meant that this all overlaps with his funeral and his estate being sorted out and things of that sort. And I was kind of conscious of, you know, I'd been to the funeral, and there were characters at the funeral who certainly fed into some of the kind of stuff I was writing. I think I look back on that now and go, oh yeah, that's where the seed of that came from. I remember being sat at the wake, and my younger brother Tom had just read Bleak House by Charles Dickens, which my wife had recommended him, you know, and he'd kind of said, I've never read any Dickens, which one should I read? And she said, well, this is my favourite. So he, you know, reported back at the wake, oh, I've read it. It doesn't seem very realistic, all of these peculiar people bickering over inheritance. And then he went to the bar to get some drinks and was like, oh, that's what all the conversations are at the bar. It's, you know, who's getting what and all of that. So those kind of things were in my head a bit. And I just wanted to write something fun and lively and have a bit of, cheer myself up, really.
The book actually kicks off in really good, lively style, and definitely a proper pre-credit sequence, which you can just imagine with the robots getting really annoyed with the Doctor and Martha.
Yeah. So I had a lot of, I found it quite hard to start, to find my way in. What I needed was a pre-title sequence that kind of set the mood of the book, that set the tone of the book. And my initial thought was I'd have them arrive on the Brilliant and kind of get into the time travel plot. And what I found was that meant that I had to explain a lot of stuff. And exposition is always, it always kind of is deadening to the mood and the tone. You kind of want to get past that as best you can. So I basically came up with the idea of doing a a sort of a James Bond thing where you effectively get a little mini movie before the titles. And yeah, and that was all inspired by my brother making some comment about Grace Kelly by Micah, which was on the radio all the time. And I just thought that gives it a bit sort of a bouncy, Tiggerish, very David Tennant Doctor feel. So I crowbarred that into a Doctor Who plot where he'd use that to stop an army of robots. And I suspect that was also my Big Finish thinking, because I populated a whole world with robots that would have the same voice. So that was, I'd done something similar in the Lost Museum, where I populated a whole load of people with a single device that would translate them. So those are the kind of things that I was thinking. And it was kind of, I think with Doctor Who, the TARDIS can go anywhere in any place and time, but where it actually ends up is in genre. So it might arrive in a horror story, or it might arrive in a, Spencer Tracy kind of knockabout adventure film, or it might end up in Star Wars or whatever. But what you have to do is kind of set that up early, and if you can be consistent with where it is, then that's satisfying. Where I think some Doctor Who stories don't work is that it kind of sets up it's going to be one kind of thing and then it isn't, and so that mismatch of tones doesn't work. So those are the kind of things that were in my head.
Yeah. And where did the idea for the scrambled egg come from, as this the time barrier between different time zones? Brilliant. It's so, there's something so easy to visualize. I suppose that's the beauty of that description.
Yeah, all of it was, how do you, I mean, I think about this all the time, wherever I'm writing, how do you make it tangible? How do you appeal to all the senses and give something that people will remember? There's loads of Doctor Who books, there's loads of Doctor Who audios and TV adventures and whatever. So how do you make yours something that will stick in the memory? And I was probably inspired by my breakfast. and was just, or maybe I, I grew up, my mum kept chickens. So we had free range eggs when I was growing up. And famously amongst, my friends, was that they would get eggs from us. But if you did any recipes, like if you did home economics at school, our eggs were very yellow. So you'd make icing, and the icing, rather than coming out white, would be bright yellow. So I was kind of thinking of, probably somebody had mentioned that, maybe at the funeral or something of that sort. So all of that went into the mix. And those kind of touchstones, I don't know. All of it was just how can I have something that's sort of engagingly odd?
Oh, well, you definitely achieved that with the Space Badgers. And it's following on from that TV following on from the TV anthropomorphic.
Animals.
Yes, following on from the anthropomorphic animals in TV, like the Jadoon.
Yeah, so I think, I can't remember exactly when, but they released images of the, or maybe it was a trailer with a Jadoon in it or something. Oh, it was merchandise, wasn't it? Because there was like an Easter egg with the Jadoon on it and stuff. And I got that cup and egg with the Jadoon on it. So probably I was inspired by that cup. But what I was thinking was, I need to tie this into what Russell T. Davies is doing with the TV show. And the Jadoon were just the latest of a number of species that were humanoid but had animal heads. And he'd done cat people and pig people and, this kind of stuff. So I was like, what other animal is there? And what animal would give me a character? And what I was thinking of was, when I was a kid, we watched school Words and Pictures, I think it was, that had a drama called Badger Girl. And my memory of Badger Girl was, it was about some developers who were going to dig up a road or build a new road or something. And that's going to basically mean digging through badger sets. And this schoolgirl, who's a bit of an environmentalist, whose nickname is Badger Girl in not a kind way, she's trying to stop the developers. And the kind of twist at the end, the badgers, you think of the badgers as being cute and cuddly, but they're actually quite vicious. So the villains kind of come in and try and attack the badgers, and the badgers attack them and they need saving from the badgers. And I, you know, that just stuck in my memory as a thing. So I just like that idea of the badgers look cute and cuddly, but they're actually quite vicious. And then the other thing that came from it was just watching my nephews, who were sort of 3 or 4, something of that sort, maybe a bit older, 5 or 6. And just watching the way they were, and they were a bit naughty and a bit funny. And I kind of thought that that's the thing I'm going to, and they're motivated by their stomachs. And I just thought that gives me a way into it.
Oh, I thought it was great, especially Archie. How can you not love Archie, despite what he does? But we'll come to that shortly. But I think they've all got their individual characteristics. They do feel like, say, naughty children's very much the way, and the delight at the ever-replenishing canopies.
Yeah, well, you know, that's just me. I just like food. But again, I was kind of like, if you're going to try and appeal to the senses, you can do what things feel like. You can do things what things look like. I was kind of like, how can I do taste and flavor? Because that's very evocative. And once I got into the idea that there was different classes of food, it gave me the whole plot, really.
It does get very timey-wimey with all the resurrections, which was a bit of a surprise. Even when rereading it, I knew there was the time loop stuff coming up, but I'd forgotten just how much there was, and that was a real surprise. And it was definitely it throws you, particularly when people get killed, and then hang on a minute.
Yeah, something that I was concerned with, is it Yesterday's Enterprise, an episode of Star Trek The Next Generation?
With Enterprise C and Tasha Yar.
Is it that one where there's one where the Enterprise keeps exploding and and it keeps going back to the same point. Maybe that's not Yesterday's Enterprise. My memory of Next Generation is all a bit muddled. But there's an episode where, and it finally gets to the point where Data knows not to do something. And what I'd found with that episode, which I probably watched around this time, or rewatched because I'd seen them all before, was that it wasn't fast enough for me. That each time they go back to the beginning of the thing, you're kind of like, oh, get on with it. I know, you know. So I was kind of very conscious of pace, and that each loop had to up the stakes. So that was the kind of plotting thing I was trying to do. And I thought, you know, oh, I can, if I've got time loops, I can, one of the things I'd done with the time travelers, or one of the things that the time travelers had tried to address, is that if you do alternate universes and changing history, nothing matters, because anything can happen and anything can be undone. So how do you make a story that has consequences where any potential reality can exist? So, and I think there was an echo of that, of just going, if I, you know, I can kill a companion or I can blow up the Doctor, but I've got to make that count. So those are the kind of things bubbling in my head.
Yeah. It also struck me as being something that younger readers would relate to, with effectively when you get killed, you go back to the start of your point of entry. And I think that's something they'd relate to from games, whether it's their Mario or whatever they'd last saved to.
Yeah, I was thinking of Snakes and Ladders, actually. That was the kind of idea. And I think at one point, the idea was that there were going to be things where they went back to, you know, you didn't go necessarily back to the start, but you went back to significant points. And that was going to be part of the functioning of the ship. And and then to simplify it, I just kind of scraped out all of that Snakes and Ladders thing.
Yeah. Now, something that did shock me was the manner in which Martha dies. She's stabbed with a knife. And I just thought, wow, that is not what I was expecting.
Yeah, this came out of... So it's established in Smith and Jones that she is a junior doctor at the Royal Hope Hospital, which is basically where St. Thomas's is in London, opposite Parliament, opposite the Palace of Westminster. And I spoke to a few people I knew who were junior doctors, and I spoke to my dad, who had been a doctor, about what her medical training would be as a junior doctor. And they all said, if you're a junior doctor in London, you would be doing knife wounds, because that is a thing you will probably have to deal with. And there are things you can do So I, you know, I was like, oh, okay, what I want to do, I want to have something in the story where she uses her medical knowledge, partly because it's established that she's a doctor, and also I absolutely loved the scene in Human Nature where she goes through the bones in the hand.
Yes.
Absolutely brilliant bit of writing by Paul Cornell, and beautifully played by Freema Agyeman as well. So I kind of wanted that moment. And basically, so I wanted was a thing that where a medical crisis that she could deal with, to up the stakes, a medical crisis affecting her that she could deal with. And then the twist at the end is it doesn't work and she dies. And I was like, that's a shocking cliffhanger. So all of those things were going into it. The version I delivered was longer because there was like a, I don't know, three paragraphs, maybe a page of what she was doing to respond to the fact that she'd been stabbed, which I spoke to a few people about and got right, and you know, how you deal with blood loss and how you deal with whatever and all of those kind of things, and trying to keep calm in the situation. And the draft of the book went off to Cardiff for approval or for notes, and it was Gary Russell who gave notes, and he basically said, this is too horrible. And not you can't do it, but just cut it right back. Just she's stabbed and she dies, you know, and just make it much more simple, which is a really, you know, because a question that came up at the time after it was published was, having done a past Doctor book, which was aimed at a more adult audience, and then done a new series book, you know, there was a kind of thing about, are you pulling your punches? Are you having to censor yourself? Are you having to whatever? And it wasn't. You could do the same. You could put in the same plot things. It was more a question of the tone with which you handled them, and you didn't linger on them. That was the kind of thing. So yeah, I was, to be honest, looking back on it, I'm amazed I got away with that, because I'm not sure you would do that now, but maybe you would. Yes, it strikes me as quite a thing. I'm not sure knife crime was quite as potent an issue as it is now. Yeah, I'm not sure I would write that now.
I suppose that's a time changes us all. But Captain Florence, she is so memorable. And it's the fact that the Badgers have all got this Southern English accent as well, from sort of Hampshire as well, just makes it all the more fun.
Yeah, well, so I grew up in Hampshire. I was born in Romsey and grew up in Winchester. So that was me. Florence was the name of my dog when I was growing up. A bit shaggy old English sheepdog. He was lovely. So yeah, so you can see I was just kind of raiding my own past, and because I was spending time in Winchester visiting my mum and going to funeral and whatever, kind of picking up bits and pieces really for my own amusement. And all the badgers were named after my friends' kids, because my friends were all starting to have babies. Yeah, so I just helped myself to people's names, really, again for my own amusement. And people were tickled by that. What I hadn't really factored in was that they would also go and buy the book that had their kids' names in. So yes, a good marketing strategy as well. I didn't do that with that in mind.
That's a great idea. And for me, it was just such a joyous read, particularly at the end when everybody's happy and they just choose to carry on and pretty much live in one big party, or so at least that's the way I interpret it. Obviously there's the choices there for those who want to go on and return to the real world, but they can carry on in this party and have a great time for the rest of their lives.
Yeah, so I wanted an ending that would linger in your memory. And again, just you know, because the volume of this amount of stuff, you know, how do you make this one that will stay with you? And one idea was that they couldn't save the ship, that for all the fun and games, they know the ship is destroyed and they can't save everyone, and that this would be a dawning revelation as they went along. And as I was writing it, I just didn't like that at all, and was just, I'm having too much fun. So I was like, no, the Doctor will save them somehow. And once I came up with the idea of, oh, the loop could be perpetual and they could all be happy, then it became a thing of, but the Doctor and Martha will escape. Who do they take with them? And I couldn't decide who they were going to take, who would stay, who would not. And then I was like, oh, but then I can make that the thing that's the hook to make it memorable. I'll leave that up to the reader. And I think looking back at it again, I think that works. I'm quite pleased with that.
Yeah. What did you think of the cover? Of course, I think you had originally had hope for some sort of space badger, but it was too scary.
Yes, that's right. That's right. So I hadn't even started writing it, really. I got the storyline approved and we would go, and then the episodes were on. So I was watching the episodes and making notes. And my friend Lee Binding got in touch and said he was going to be doing the cover. And I said, can I pitch you something? Can I pitch you an idea? And I had drawn a very bad sketch of a cover with a badger pirate on it, with an earring to show that it was a pirate loop, and kind of said to Lee, could we do that? So he mocked something up, kind of going, is this the sort of thing? And it was judged to be too scary. So they wanted something a bit more straightforward. And he put together a thing of a spaceship traveling through a vortex. And so I worked his image into my descriptions of the book. But it was great. And yeah, I love working with Lee. I've worked with him on loads of stuff before and since. And it was just very, very, you know, very amenable and easy, really. And also what that means is that people imagine what the badgers look like and how... You know, I've spoken to some people who kind of go, they'd look like the badgers from Harry Hill. And others who are kind of like, no, they'd look a bit more, you know, Millennium FX would have done them, and they'd have been a bit more horror filmy. So, yeah, you can kind of, without showing people what they are, you can do all of that work yourself.
My version in my head, somewhere in between, where they've got sort of like pirate clothes on and they're sort of cuddly, but they do have the old animatronic snarling moments. So that's how I see them, with eye patches and stuff.
I don't know if you've heard the audiobook version of Pirate Loop.
I've not heard it yet. I do have it, but I've not listened to it.
So the extraordinary thing about that is it's half as long as the novel. So Steve Tribe amazingly cuts every other word in a story that's all about time loops and continuity and stuff. So he couldn't cut every other word. What he had to do was take out sections. And amazing, absolutely amazing piece of work, and seamless. And they sent me I thought it was impossible, and they sent me the draft he'd done. And I think I picked up one thing. And also, he wasn't allowed to add anything. He could only cut what I'd done. Amazing, absolutely amazing piece of work. But it's read by Freema Agyeman, and she is fantastic as the Badgers. Absolutely fantastic as the Badgers. And I think I had a conversation in 2008, it must have been. Tom Baker had made it known to BBC Audio that in principle he might be up for doing original audiobooks as the Doctor. So not just reading old Target books, he'd do something original. And we were asked, a bunch of us were asked to submit ideas. And I sent in a few. And one of the ideas I had was it'd be Tom Baker with Freema Agyeman, and Freema would be playing Space Pirate Badgers. And my memory is, I may have this wrong, my memory is, and I sent in all sorts of things, and a horror one and a spooky one and whatever. And my memory is that I think the idea was that it was all to get Nick Courtney to do something, but Nick couldn't do a whole day in the studio. So the idea was that Tom would lead it and Nick would be able to come in and be a supporting actor for some of it. So that was the kind of setup. And there was lots of back and forth, but it didn't happen. But there was, you know, there was the suggestion that the Badger Pirates might return.
That's brilliant. Oh,
and they were going to be against... they were going to attack a spaceship of old age pensioners. That was the that was the idea. In what I now realise is kind of, have you seen Cockneys versus Zombies?
Yes.
By James Moran. Yeah, it would have been somewhere along the same lines. Cockneys versus Zombies in space was what I was basically. Yeah.
Badgers versus pensioners. Yeah. It works. It works.
Yeah, and I think similarly to the pirate loop, the badgers would have been jealous of the pensioners sort of sitting around having cups of tea and digestive biscuits. And the pensioners would have been jealous of the badgers charging about having a great old time. So they swapped. That was the kind of wheeze at the... it's ridiculous, really. I can't imagine why they went, no, we'll do something else.
We got Hornet's Nest instead, which was as bonkers.
That's what it all led to.
Brilliant. What do you remember of the signing with the other Decemberists?
Oh, yeah, so did we do one in London? I think we might have done Forbidden Planet, sort of like the week after Christmas, and it was a bit quiet. And then we were all shipped up to Manchester, and I think that was in early January of 2008. And my brother-in-law came with one of his mates, and by that point, the short story competition I had been judging had all been done and dusted, and I was working on a book of the winning short stories, and two of the authors came along. So I met for the first time in person two of the people I'd been working with. And then I think there were three families who came, I think. So there was about 20 people, but 10 of them were in three families, and the rest were people who'd come to see me. I think Jim might have had some mates, maybe Trevor had some mates, but it was a bit small and quiet. And we had a quiz or something like that where you could win the three books, and two of the families already had the three books. So the only people who didn't have the books, there was like one thing. So it basically said, well, we might as well just give you the books. But it was fun. It was fun. It was a bit odd because other book signings had been huge, and it was just the wrong time of year, I think. But very pleasant. They put Jim up in a very posh hotel, I remember. And he arrived in his room to find there was a bottle of wine and whatever. Whereas I was staying, I think, on the floor at my brother-in-law's little house and stuff. So I was like, I should have stayed in the hotel. But it was fun. It was fun. And I now live down the road from where my brother-in-law was. So, yeah. It's odd. It's odd. But I've done signings that are huge, and I've done signings where I did a Doctor Who writing workshop where one person came. So literally we sat opposite each other and had a cup of tea and a bit of a gossip. And it was quite nice and quite intimate, but a bit odd.
Yeah. So I think it's fair to say, to sum up our chat, you have a hell of a lot of fondness for the Pirate Loop today, all these years later.
Yeah, it's fun. It's fun. There's two things. One is that my wife still thinks it's the best thing I've written, or I think she thinks it's the most me, and it's my sense of humour and my attitude to lots of stuff. So that's good, but does kind of rather suggest that my career has been downhill since 2007. The other thing that's odd, because I'm very old, is I now meet and in some cases work with people who read that book as kids and remember it. And it kind of sticks in the memory as a fun one, which is, you know, a bit weird, you know, to be part of somebody's childhood. Gratifying, but makes me feel like I'm as ancient as the Dales, really. And it's quite odd. It is quite odd to have bits of things you've written quoted back to you. Very nice, but I realise how I must seem to people I know who've worked on Doctor Who on TV and things. But yeah, it's nice. It's a nice thing to be remembered for, because it is fun. I was flicking through it this morning and just going, I'd forgotten how stupid some of these jokes are. And I think I just wrote it to, you know, because there was a lot going on at the time in my family and stuff. I just wrote it to cheer people up, really. And I think on that score, it worked.
Fingers crossed that your own kids will be able to pick it up and enjoy it one day. And
oh no, they won't touch anything with my name on it. They
can't. What?
Very scornful.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, and I don't want to force any of that on them. You know, just yeah. If they do, that's fine. And my son wants copies of things. So the David Whittaker book that came out last year, he saw the limited edition pink hardback and went, I want one of those. He doesn't want to read it. He just wants his copy of it. So he's got that. And then he noticed it was roughly the same size as the Daily Doctor. So he, you know, and I had a box of those. So it's like, can I have one of those as well? And then I was like, do you want any of the other books? No, because they won't fit on the shelf. Okay. So, you know, I know my place.
Simon, thank you so much. It's been a real pleasure to take a wee trip down memory lane and go round and chat about the Pirate Loop.
Yeah, it's very fitting. Thank you, Kenny.
Huge thanks to Simon for taking the time. It was, I thought we'd have a 20-odd minute chat. Turned into about 45 minutes, so can't be a bad thing.
Longest podcast ever.
On a book, possibly,
on
yes.
A book, yeah.
I said Managra's quite close, but that's coming up in the near future. Or was it in the past? I don't know.
Who knows?
The only way to find out is to have a quick look at our episode list. So so there, yes. But no, I'm just having a quick look at Goodreads, and this has got a rating of 3.83. And of the ratings, 28% have given it 5 stars, 35% have given it 4 stars, and 29% have given it 3 stars, and the others are just completely wrong. So, yeah, I think it's... And it's had 131 reviews. So there we go. So yeah, I think it's a great read. And if you're going to pick up a Doctor Who novel and you want one that's going to give you a good laugh and entertain you, I'd say this is a good recommendation for that.
Absolutely. Is this the kind of thing that would be picked up and turned into audio at some point, do you think?
I think it would be great if it were. Freeman did the audiobook reading, of course.
Mm-hmm.
But... And as Simon said, there was potentially plans to use Freema alongside Tom for a spin-off Fourth Doctor series, but it never came to be.
Mm-hmm.
But I can't see Big Finish getting the rights to do these, as the BBC seem to hold them for themselves, and Big Finish can only do Virgin books from bygone days if they want to. But it looks like the final one is going to be Goth Opera.
No, right.
Not I'm saying all to Goth Opera, I'm saying all to potentially the end of the range. But...
The end. But as you said before, I mean, this could have been filmed, this could have been real. Of course it's real. I reckon you could still turn that into a decent episode now.
It would work on the telly.
That's what I mean. Let's petition Badgers for Doctor Who Disney.
Doctor Who and the Space Badgers of Disney.
I think Doctor Who and the Space Badgers is an excellent title.
Mm, which also reminds me, what's the difference between Bing Crosby and Walt Disney?
Bing something's Walt Disney, I don't know.
Bing sings and Walt Disney. Anyway.
Oh dear.
Right, okay. I think that's fair to say that we've exhausted the lame gags for tonight, or today, I should say.
Well, we've probably exhausted what we should broadcast.
Yes.
I mean, the viewers are dropping off by their millions as we speak.
Oh, damn it. Anyway, Steevie, I was thinking this book actually gives us a clue as to what we're going to play out with.
Does it? Pirate Kenny?
It does.
Be there a song called The Pirates or The Loop? Or is there a song called The Pirate Loop.pdf?
There is not, to the best of my knowledge.
Ah.
No, it's not going to be anything from The Pirates of Penzance or HMS Pinafore, which would have been great.
That would be good.
But I'm going to go for something that's actually mentioned in the text of the book, right mm-hmm. at the start.
Go on then.
When the Doctor and Martha are escaping from the robots.
Mm-hmm.
And what song do they refer to?
I can't remember.
Ah, it's Mika's Grace Kelly. So let's go with Grace Kelly from
always
Mika.
Always go with Grace Kelly.
Ah, so graceful. Anyway, thanks for tuning in, everybody. I've been Kenny.
I've been Badger Steevie.
And this is Mika. Bye.
Bye.
Do I attract you? Do I repulse you with my queasy smile? Am I too dirty? Am I too flirty? Do I like what you like? Yeah, I could be wholesome, I could be loathsome, guess I'm a little bit shy. Why don't you like me? Why don't you like me without making me try? I try to be like Chris Kelly, but all her looks were too sad. So I tried a little Freddy. I've got an entity mind.